Okay, well, welcome everyone who's here already. I'm admitting people. Again, thank you for your patience and willingness to rejoin us on today's rescheduled Q&A. I'm sort of embarrassed at my mistake, which I won't go into, but it was an easy fix to fix once I realized what was going on. So I'm sorry that it upset everybody's schedule for Monday. So I'm delighted to have with me again Felicia Amenta for our monthly Q&A. And so this will be the last one for 2021. And let's hope 2022 is a very different looking year. Unfortunately, it's not looking so different right now as we wrap up this year, but we'll see where it goes. So welcome, Felicia.
Welcome, Debra. I'm happy to be here. It's my pleasure.
Great, great. Well, we've had a lot of changes just this week. And in a way, you know, in retrospect, it was like, maybe it was a good thing we did reschedule, because anything we said on Monday was likely to change in the next couple of days. And so that's what our goal is today, is to bring people up to date on what we know and understand. And I think, you know, if you even watch the news as recently as this morning, you know, things continue to take a very different turn. And so we'll see. But that's part of what part of what's important as we manage our employees with medical conditions, the interactive process, is to retain some flexibility, some resiliency, open-mindedness, because more and more people are getting impacted every day. And who knows, it could be you, it could be me, it could be any of us. And the shoe could be on the other foot. That's where I always like to think about it when I'm looking at options. Just what would I want to happen if this was me? And how would I want people to engage? So Felicia, let's talk about the trends as we know it, December 16th.
Well, I got my notes ready on Monday for our Q&A, and then we had so many changes this week, I had to keep adding and amending my notes. But I think I'll start with the updates on the OSHA emergency temporary standard. Even though we are already following in education in California a vaccination mandate or weekly testing and masking, and we've been doing this since October 15th, so we're a couple months into this process, but federal OSHA has issued the emergency temporary standards last month, you know, in November, which we talked about in our last Q&A, and that's for all employers with 100 or more to develop, implement, and enforce a mandatory COVID-19 vaccination policy or a testing and maxing policy. And that was supposed to be effective on January 4th, 2022. There were many states that brought challenges to that mandate, and the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals granted a temporary injunction, as we talked about last month, prohibiting enforcement of the mandate nationwide. Then the cases have now been consolidated, and the Sixth Circuit's Court of Appeals is soon to decide whether to dissolve or modify the injunction and allow the administration to enforce the vaccination or testing mandate while the further litigation is pending. OSHA argued that the Sixth Circuit should lift the stay and allow OSHA to enforce parts of the emergency temporary standard of masking, testing, and for the employers to adopt the COVID-19 policies. There were comments on that were due, and they say that the Sixth Circuit is going to issue a response by the end of December. So more to follow on that. That's still remains to be seen what happens with that, but we think it's going to happen within the next couple of months. The other very big regulatory change was the EEOC regulatory update that was effective this Tuesday on December 14th. And that was the regulation on basically talking about, that the EEOC recognizes that long COVID is maybe a disability under the ADA, you know, for the accommodation and the IPM process. And so prior to making job offers, they talk about some of the things that employers need to look at. Flexibility by employers and employees is stressed to be important in determining some of the accommodations possible with these long-haul COVID cases. And one is that temporary job restructuring duties may be needed. Two, temporary transfers to other positions. Three, modified work schedules or shift assignments. And people that feel significant stress due to the COVID-19 pandemic, those issues need to be considered. And they also talked about, it's just not that you've tested positive for COVID. That does not meet the definition under the new regulations. There are some questions and there's some guidance on the EEOC website that we might be able to provide out based on the Tuesday update of things to consider when you do get a request for an accommodation for symptoms of long haul COVID. They give examples of cardiac problems, breathing problems, fatigue problems, and memory loss or brain fog problems that need to be considered. So so that's new as of 12/14.
And let me just interject there then, is what I'll do is I've been tracking some of the EEOC guidance pretty closely, not only on long haul COVID symptoms, but also a request for religious accommodation and things like that. And so I will pull together before we release the recording so people do have access to that in our follow-up email. But I want to point out that, you know, some of the accommodations that you identified are actually accommodations that have already been in practice for a long time, mm-hmm. and things that we should consider for all employees with medical conditions. And so nothing new in terms of EEOC offering up examples, but to acknowledge that, you know, again, we are aware that some people do have ongoing long-term effects from COVID, not everybody. And so it's really important for us to understand that it's not just being tested for COVID, but actually experiencing long-term effects. Again, medical documentation can be requested to substantiate, just like any other medical condition under the ADA. And I know that a lot of employers, have a mistaken notion, unfortunately, that they can't ask for information. It's like, no, the ADA and EEOC are very clear about the kinds of information you can ask and we can get pretty sure. So I know both you and I can assist employers on that in terms of how to go about it. And if we have time, I'll share some recommended practices when more information is needed.
Great. And then, of course, the latest and greatest that on Wednesday, 12/15, the California Department of Health re-implemented the mask mandate and then masks for indoor settings. And then masks are required now for large concert venues and large gatherings in outdoor spaces. And that is due to the rising COVID-19 case numbers and fears of the the transmissible Omicron new variant, that they're worried that could spawn a new wave. And so that's why that mask mandate was re-implemented. And then that's gonna last a month. And then the California Public Health Department will make further recommendations as needed. And this applies, of course, regardless of your vaccination status. We in education were already masking indoors. What I have seen, because I was visiting a lot of districts this last couple of weeks, and the one thing that I did see as of Wednesday is that districts that had the ruling that you could take off your mask if you were inside a closed office inside of a building now kind of have, some districts have switched that and you need to wear the mask even if you're in an office with a closed door or in a building because you're still in an indoor space. So, and I saw that on yesterday, you know, on the day that it was implemented, I saw that change. We even did a Zoom call with a district and they were in the process of doing an email to all staff changing that rule. So,
yeah, so before it used to be that you could remove your mask when not in the presence of students, but now it's back to any presence inside a building to be wearing masks at all times.
Okay. And they did say that the rule was re-implemented to ensure we get through a time of joy and hope without a darker cloud of concern and despair. So okay. I thought that was an interesting comment. And that mandate does not apply to private gatherings in one's home.
Okay. Okay, good. Good to clarify. I will say that just as of this morning, there are two CEOs for major airlines, and unfortunately, I didn't catch which airlines they were, but they're challenging mask wearing on planes. And so that will be an interesting situation given the holiday travel that's expected. And I know I will certainly rethink some travel I've scheduled, depending upon how things go for March when I'm supposed to speak at a major conference. You know, so it's really interesting, you know, some organizations are still actively challenging it. And yet, again, reports I heard about Omicron, it only takes about 3 or 4 days for it to blossom. And and oftentimes it shows up as like cold symptoms. So it's recommended that if you have any symptomology, you know, to seek testing because it's not as strong, but it's more rapidly transmitted.
And that's how we're seeing it show up in our employee population, because as everybody knows on this meeting, COVID can be work-related and be a work comp claim in California. Yes. And that's how we're seeing it as symptoms of a cold. Employees reporting in that they don't feel well and that they think they have a cold. And sometimes the district will ask them, well, do you think you have COVID? Should you go get tested? And sometimes the response is no, but some of them have gone and gotten tested and they have COVID. And that's what they thought, they had a cold. So Omicron does sort of look very similar, right? The types of complaints. It's more upper respiratory than it is lungs from what we're hearing now, right? Because this is very ongoing and dynamic.
Yeah. Well, and it's challenging too, because this is a typical, you know, cold flu season anyway. We've had such rapidly changing weather, you know, from being very nice and warm in the 70s and 80s to what we've experienced the last 2 days down in the, I think it was 44 where I live this morning. So, and of course, all the rain that we had just a couple of days ago with more to come. So, you know, it is, heightened awareness, being open to, you know, this could be it, you know, and so, take care of yourself first and foremost, and by doing so, you're going to be taking care of those around you. And I think that's a philosophy we've always sort of maintained since the onset of COVID. Do what you need to be safe.
I did want to clarify that in the EEOC guidance on Tuesday, one of the interesting things that they added was that to qualify for under the ADA, a person would have to show one of the following: an actual disability, such as a physical or mental impairment that limits a major life activity, right? You know, under the ADA, a record of or a disability shows the worker's record of impairment, or be regarded as an individual of disability, meaning an employer takes some action against a person due to a perception that the worker has disability. And that perception piece, I think, is important because you and I have been running up into that. And they said a worker who tests positive and is asymptomatic or has mild symptoms similar to a cold or flu would not qualify, says the EEOC. So that kind of clarifies that a little bit.
Yeah. Well, and I would like to add then those three factors, again, have always been part of the ADA. And so it's, again, just to emphasize, an actual disability that you could visibly see or a record of that's been reported. Or if you're treating somebody differently, being regarded as. And so that's why I'm going to emphasize again, is that if you have knowledge of somebody who has had a medical condition, that is actually a trigger for activating the interactive process to see what's going on and what needs might they have in order to function in all of the essential functions of the job to the level of performance necessary. And I see too often that people's performances will start to slip, and not that they shouldn't be, disciplined accordingly, but if you see a change in behavior, particularly around performance or attendance or tardiness, there could be something medically going on. And many employees, again, do not know or are not familiar with the ADA. And so this is where an employer, being the big brother or big sister per se, needs to demonstrate their knowledge, willingness, and flexibility in taking a look at these circumstances to keep people working. That's really the goal of the ADA, is to keep people working, and two for PIHA too.
Yes. Yeah, I agree.
So those are the recent trends. Anything that's on the forefront, Felicia, that you are aware of that we should be looking for?
That's what's going on right now. Certainly on our next Q&A, we should have some update on the OSHA emergency temporary standard. But that, again, is not affecting us so much in education because we are basically already doing it. And I have to say it's working at least with our employee population at the county office. It's been running fairly smoothly. Our employees that are not vaccinated, everyone loaded their cards up into PeopleSoft, and which is the mechanism that we use to do that. And then they're doing their weekly testing through the county Department of Health. And that is uploaded every week. And the supervisors and the managers are managing that process. And then if you do test positive, then you have to, obviously you're taken out of work.
Right. Okay. Very good. Well, like we said in the beginning, stay tuned. There's more to come and more to evolve, and I appreciate the statement from the Department of Public Health as far as trying to get through these holidays as safely and effectively as we can, so that we show up on the other side in 2022. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yep. Well, I'd like to hear from you on this one, Felicia. As far as what are you seeing in terms of some of the accommodation practices around exemptions, with medical conditions, religious accommodations, anything like that. I mean, and let's talk about what I'm seeing too.
Mm-hmm. So because we were following Governor Newsom's vaccination mandate for education, and we are allowing unvaccinated workers can continue to work and they're masking, and as we all are indoors, and but they're weekly testing. And so we are not asking for the religious exemption information, but I am seeing, we are seeing a lot of rise, I have to say, in stress claims. And I've seen it, and I think you have seen it too. I've seen it in the work comp space ever since our members reopened for in-person instruction in August. And I have been seeing it in the non-industrial space, not for a work comp claim, just for general anxiety and depression. And then I've also seen it because I manage the MHNE's counseling program. And I've seen an uptick in the use of those counseling services, not only for our employees, but their family members as well. So certainly we can agree that it's a stressful arena. And I do think flexibility is so important because those stress claims on the work comp end and on the non-industrial end have very different work restrictions. They're very different, and sometimes they can be very difficult to accommodate. And I do think that it's very important, though, to address them early on rather than downstream 3 or 4 months on. Yeah, things usually can get more complicated and more confusing as time goes on if we don't address them early.
Absolutely. And a couple of things about that is that, again, early response to people's stated concerns and is really, really important. And early referral to EASE whatever EAP is available through the health insurance plan too, because that's, you're already paying for it. It's free. And if employees are reporting stress or, difficulties at work that are more psychological in nature rather than physical, at least they're getting some help rather than, I mean, we all know how long it can take to get through the workers' comp system. And so if somebody needs help, they may not be getting the treatment that they need. And so EAP is an excellent resource to get people seen and supported to help them through difficult times. And by doing an early inquiry through the IPM, then, again, is it something you can help with, but at least demonstrate your support. And that sort of early show of support and compassion goes a long way in preventing or reducing the potential for either a workers' comp claim or a civil claim for not being accommodated. And so, when people feel supported, they're less likely to take adverse action. And not that workers' comp is an adverse action, but it's a complicated system. And so it doesn't really treat their needs as effectively, efficiently as we would like to see.
Well, and I think because stress claims are so different from physical injuries in that physical injuries don't need to meet the 51% threshold of being work-related, whereas psychological stress claim does in the workers' comp system. And so while they're in delay and being investigated and looked at, which can take 3 or 4 months in the California system, we encourage districts on the other track to take a look at all those work restrictions from reports either from the group health side or the work comp physicians and start addressing those early on. So you kind of have two tracks running, right? You're working with the claims team on they're doing the delay and investigation process, and then you're meeting with the employee to talk about these work restrictions, which usually are can't work with this supervisor, cannot work with this coworker. I've seen the words cannot work at or near, can't work for at or near. That was the note I, you know, recently saw. And so usually they can sometimes work in any other department or in under any other supervisor or in any other environment while they're getting treatment for what is going on at work. And also we've got mediation and training assistance available through the 𝐀𝐠𝐢MHN program. So I just think sometimes we're not taking advantage of all of the resources that we have.
Yeah. And, you know, with that, I'm glad to hear that 𝐀𝐠𝐢 does offer its management training, right?
It is.
Yeah. And you know, for those of participating today, you may or may not know, but I also offer a training for managers on how to use the process, you know, what kind of questions to ask in the confidential setting to help equip and inform managers and supervisors who are usually the first point of contact for an employee, you know, and how to respond. And it's really important also, the EEOC, you know, takes a very serious look at attitudes, biases, and things like that. And so it's real important that we check ourselves to make sure that, you know, particularly if we have a history with an employee, that we, you know, still be proactive and initiate early, because failure to take action because of some belief or bias about somebody, again, does not bode well for the employer in the long run. And, you know, there are, it's known in my field anyway, that there are 9 common triggers that provoke emotional responses. And many of us do have cognitive distortions that will bias our behavior and attitude and how we show up with others. So, you know, it's just particularly around stress claims, it's so important to be open about this. And we all know we have difficult employees, but that doesn't mean even really good managers sometimes don't misstep and handle things inappropriately. And so,
Agree.
I see that come up all the time in mediations in general, not just interactive process. And so, just very aware that the EEOC, you know, is mindful about attitude and bias on that. Yeah. What would you say, we've sort of touched a couple times, Felicia, but, you know, in terms of best practices, again, from your perspective, managing the JPA and your long history of working with medical conditions, you know, what are some tips and strategies that you have for suggesting best practices for our participants to consider?
One of the things that I try to do, and I always recommend that that our members try to do as well, in our partners in education and our team members, I try to look at each case on its own merits. A lot of times I'll hear them say, we don't want to set a precedent. We don't want to do for one what we are not willing to do for everyone. We're not going to remove this person from this classroom or this person from this supervisor, because maybe we'll have to do that for everyone that comes in and complains about a person or a supervisor. And I guess I try not to make decisions that way. I try to make decisions just based on the case in front of me, take it on its own merits, and I kind of sweep away all of those other considerations and just look at what's reasonable for that case. Because otherwise, I think those blind spots can kind of hurt you. And I also think I try not to get entrenched too much in a feeling or a decision and try to look big picture. Where are we going in the end? Where is this going to end up? And what's the best thing to do for the school district involved? Rather than get very emotionally charged about and hung up on one particular thing. I try to take the emotion and the personal, and obviously it's very personal to the employees and to any injured team members, but I still try to take a longer view. How is this going to play out? What's going to be the end game? What's the best thing to do in the long run? And I just think, and trying to be very flexible, because I have seen some districts take the position, well, we're just not going to do this. But I sort of think, well, let's just look at everything. What's going to be the best thing to do? Let's not try to say that's off the table. Because sometimes right in the beginning, they say that's off the table. You know, that student's in the classroom. She has to teach that classroom. There's no other classroom. And I said, well, can we just keep an open mind about, because that's really what you're supposed to be doing, instead of just, sometimes what happens is options are eliminated right up front. We're not doing this. And I try not to think that way. I just try not to.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. I know we just had this conversation yesterday, so I'll bring it up. And then two is that, you know, in reference to what you just said, is that, you know, if you come in with a preconceived notion of the your desired outcome, that's a position and that's non-negotiable. And that's exactly the opposite of what a mediation or a facilitated interactive process is supposed to be. And so you may have ideas about what kind of outcome you want, but to say, I absolutely will not do this is, again, a shot in the foot when it comes to any potential EEOC action, because then they say you're not entering into the process in good faith to be open to possibilities. And as a mediator, I always put out to participants, maybe not so much in the interactive process, but in employment mediations in general, is that, you know, when we're talking about ideas, you know, even the craziest ideas sometimes have a kernel of something we can work with. And so put out any idea that comes into play, and then we all evaluate whether or not it's readily achievable, doable, effective in performing the essential functions. And like I say, you know, being at work, staying at work, and performing the work.
One of the cases that I was looking at that came down under the EEOC, it was very interesting, and it was a fine against the employer in this particular case. And I always read them because I want to know what happened and what went on. And what happened was there was a work restriction, and that work restriction stayed in play for about 4 or 5 months. But what the EEOC said was all the employer said was, we're not doing it. That's it. They said, you didn't come up with any alternatives. You didn't explore anything else. You didn't look at any other jobs. You didn't think about any other departments, even on a temporary basis. You just said, no, no, no. Can't do it, won't do it. And it didn't look good, right? The optics, even if they had explored some things, but they didn't work out and they couldn't do them. They said you didn't explore anything in the short term, not even the long term. You didn't even explore anything that you could do maybe to the end of the school year. You didn't explore anything, any options. You didn't come up with any options. You just said, no, we can't accommodate this restriction. And they were saying it should be a little more interactive than that.
Well, and that's what it's called, the interactive process, you know, which is a form of mediation. And one of the things, and you touched on this a couple times, Felicia, and we talked about it yesterday, is that, you know, if you feel that as an employer, you are faced with a challenging situation, or, you know, let's say a difficult employee or difficult circumstances around someone's, claimed medical condition, you know, talk to somebody like you or talk to somebody like me, and it might even be necessary to confer with legal counsel. And then too, like you do, I do too, is actively read what kind of EEOC decisions have come down, because then that can be guidance for us as we try to deal with current situations so that we don't make the same mistake that employers have already been found, in the wrong, on the wrong side of the table, let's say, for these interactive meetings. And so, you know, check, well, have you seen the kind of situation before? You know, has there any case law that's been decided? You know, or what can we deduce from, recent decisions or claims pending? Because quite often, you know, unless the employer has demonstrated that good faith, you know, interactive process, in that they've really tried to work with the employee, the EEOC, you know, is going to side with the employee because, again, big brother, big sister, employers are supposed to be in the know and to keep their employees working. And when there's not been good faith efforts like that, then EEOC will go against them and the fines can be substantial.
And I have been seeing the trend in workers' comp, especially in the last 2 years with COVID, that our COVID stress claims are being accepted more than not, both by the physicians and the QMEs and by the judges, because of all the ambient stress that's going on. If there's any question, they're leaning over, they're leaning in towards giving the benefits to the employee, and workers' comp is a benefit system. As it is, we can question claims, but it is a benefit system. So I really like, we have one really large school district, and when their new risk manager came, and this was many, many years ago, he said, why are so many people off work for work injuries? Why are so many people off work on illness? And then he took a look at the return to work program, and they sort of reworked it. And the whole mindset and culture is we want to keep you at work. And it's both on the illness side, they don't look at their return to work program is the same, whether you have a sick note and you're ill or whether you have a work comp note, unless you're completely off. And even if you're off, they will engage and say, hey, could you do this or that or this? Could you go talk to the doctor? Let's talk to the work comp doctor. They will actively try to keep, their whole mindset is we want to keep everybody at work. We want to bring everybody back to work. And we don't want anyone to lose their job because due to illness, disability, or injury, unless there's nothing we can do. And that's their mindset. And they've gotten quite creative, and they've lowered their temporary disability greatly for their work comp injuries. But they've also, because they use this practice, non-industrial, the same, they've lowered their illness days out of work because of this mindset. So when I have new people that start, I always tell them to call this district. And there's two people in their risk management department, but talk to them because they really have changed the culture, because that's really what you have to do. Their employees all know that if they're ill or if they're hurt on the job, that they're going to engage. The risk department and HR are going to engage them to keep them at work.
I've been really pleased to hear about those kinds of practices, because when I first got involved back in 1993, ABA was had been passed, but it was implemented for employment in 1992. But I happened to be in a position of where I was very, closely involved with workers' comp and with a team of professionals in California trying to interpret what does this ABA mean for employers, particularly around work-related injuries. And from there, I expanded into other conditions too. But that I had the good opportunity of working with a public agency. I wasn't a school district, but it was, very, it had all kinds of positions like the schools do also. Mm-hmm. And they had a huge rate of workers' comp, phenomenal. I'd even heard about it before I ever talked to them because I was doing some work for their TPA. But then also they did get sued for a failure to accommodate under the ADA very early on, and not even the attorneys knew what to do about it. And so, fortunately I had listening ears, and they were really serious about, we've got to do something different. This is going to bankrupt us if this keeps going on. And so it took about, design and implemented the program. It took about a 3-year process. And that's pretty consistent when we're talking about culture change, mm-hmm. to see the impact of the program, the benefits of the program. Again, it changes the attitude of union representation when mm-hmm. they see that cooperative environment. You get amazingly loyal employees who have been supported and assisted and returned to work as soon as reasonably possible. And they had a past history of people being out ad nauseum, mm-hmm. 2-3 years. In fact, mm-hmm. I just did a case last week where someone's been out of work for 2.5 years. I mean, work practices have changed so much. And so we had to design a whole transition plan just to help her bring her back up to speed and then monitor to see if it's working. But you can really do a lot if you just sort of take a look at, well, how's this working for us? What are your workers' comp costs? What are your health claim costs? What is your absenteeism or sick day rates looking like? And all of those are indicators of, how well is your program working? Because there's a lot that can be done that really doesn't have to cost a lot. It's just, like you said, a shift in mindset, you know, a shift in workplace culture. That's exciting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think so too.
Any other best practices to offer up? And then I want to go to our last point that we had identified for today, emergency staffing.
The only thing I was going to add too is we've been seeing a rise since August, since all of our over 60 school district and charter school members reopened in new injuries and work comp claims. And a lot of the risk and HR staff are like, what is going on? You know, what's happening? And the one thing I can say anecdotally is from a lot of our staff that were not as active as they normally are when they're working, getting up, going to work, driving a bus, you know, making the food, whatever it is that you're doing, working in special ed, there's been a great surge in activity. So, and then also just having everybody back together, working with students in person rather than Zoom just lends itself to more exposure, especially in the special ed arenas. And then people doing more lifting, pushing, pulling, reaching, grabbing, kneeling, getting their classrooms set up. We've been seeing a lot of physical injuries. And I think after a big disruption like this, that would not be that abnormal. Although the claims team wants it to stop, but they said, when is this going to stop? And I said, when we go on break in next week, it's going to stop. How about that? I think that that's been kind of an interesting thing to see. And then the stress claims make sense to me, right? Because the pandemic is still going on, because the new variants are still there, and because of the masking and the vaccination, and there's still being some, I'll say, conflict, right, with parents and with students. There's a lot of issues going on that are affecting our teammates and our staff. So I think being very compassionate and, like I always say, leading with love, you know, that's just the way that's the only way through, right? It's being very empathetic. It was always important in HR and risk and work comp, but it is more important now than it ever was.
Yeah, we have a whole new world out there, right, baby?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, and your last point then leads to our last point, is that, you know, with these increases in claims and so forth, you know, school districts, third-party administrators have really had to shift around who's doing what, et cetera, and for compliance purposes, with all these new on-site requirements, but then also just managing the surge of claims. And so what are you seeing around that? Because I know you and I have talked that, you know, what are you seeing?
So it's interesting. Just like the rise in claims and the rise in workload affected our claims team at our TPA Athens to the point where we're going to add to staff. We are adding a new team member immediately now because some of our examiners are experiencing stress, right? And workload difficulties and not having to authorize overtime, not being able to get their work done in a regular day. And I do not want that to be their work-life balance, right? That they're working in the evenings on the weekends. And so we are emergently adding to staff to try to address that. What I've seen out at the districts is kind of the same. Our charter schools and our member districts are also experiencing workload increases due to COVID compliance, reporting of COVID, and general oversight of the contact tracing and the whole process. Some of that was just redistributed. Some districts just redistributed duties and everybody got a little bit of the additional duties. Some districts took COVID and dropped it in risk management's lap and they had to do everything. Contact tracing, the letters, the notifications, all of it. And then some districts dropped that into HR and dropped that completely into HR and then HR had to handle it. Because those duties added extra time and people were already busy, some districts that I've gone to, and even this last week when I was doing some holiday visits, I noticed, I heard a lot of different responses. Some districts are hiring some temporary staff or substitute staff because they don't know how long these additional duties are going to last, right? Because of the compliance and COVID and contact tracing. And some of the districts have just bit the bullet and said, okay, we needed kind of to add a half a person anyway, we're just going to add a person and we're going to redistribute the duties. And then some districts are not adding to staff at all. Their staff are just like right here. And I have seen turnover. I've seen because we have over 60 members, I see a lot. And what I see is people that have, you know, so much to do that they're retiring a little bit early because it's just, they're on burnout overload. And I've also seen people leave and take another job that they feel might be not so stressful. So I think we have to be mindful. Like my claims team, the minute I started hearing I'm working in the evenings and I can see their work. So I see them working at 9 or 10 o'clock at night, and that is not acceptable. And that means they can't get their workload done in the daytime in their regular hours, which means they have to work overtime when they're supposed to be with their family. And that means we need to add to staff, right? Because our workloads are rising.
Well, you know, thanks for that update, because I know I think we saw a lot of change over this summer of 2020, you know, where a lot of people who've been around for a while left because they could. And so a lot of new people are into their current positions. And then we're seeing that again now as, you know, COVID has stretched out and compliance issues remain. And yeah, people are just burnt out. They're just way too much to do. I do have a suggestion that ties back to best practices. And this is where my other public agency became highly successful, is they had four special projects, and then they had a bank of temporary modified duty that where someone could be placed in any department. And so particularly during this COVID time when there is increased workload, you know, when and where appropriate, it'd be an excellent way to use an employee off for a medical condition that could work, but maybe not in their usual job because you're paying them already. Mm-hmm. And so it'd be a way of getting that extra support, that extra help that from existing employees, and just, you know, temporarily, like you said, reassigning them to help out with, you know, so again, like your usual temporary accommodations in, 60 or 90 day increments. And then if there's an ongoing need and they're still not able to go back to the usual job, then you could extend it for another 60 to 90 days. And that's all within the bargained agreements and, and an excellent way. And that's sort of what that one school district that you talked about earlier did. They put people back to work anywhere that they could. And with my public agency before, is knowing that they had a bank of, some departments always need extra help. And so that was a common way for people to get assigned somewhere, either part-time or full-time, but to keep them engaged in the workplace. And it really, boy, you put somebody like, for example, who's used to working outdoors into an indoor position, they got well really quickly.
Right. Working in the office, answering phones. I want to go back to being a groundskeeper.
Exactly. So it could be a great motivator. But I also saw some opportunities where, you know, because they had a lot of construction and maintenance workers throughout their area. And it, because of the temporary modified program, we also saw employees who gained new job skills in areas where they didn't have them. And so then they were able to actually, you know, move on and apply for jobs that, you know, were better suited for their physical limitations rather than continuing with that outdoor work that they used to do.
Right. And the large district that we were referring to that has the really robust return to work program on steroids is what I like to call it. They actually have, like you said, jobs set aside for injured workers. They know about how many injured workers they're going to have at any different time. And they actually set aside jobs for them to do. And then if they do get notes saying that they can't work at all or they're off sick, they engage and say, hey, we have these quite a few light duty jobs. Would you be interested in doing any of them temporarily? And this is for sick, illness, and for workers' comp. And sometimes the response is, no, I'm good. You know, I'm off work for my doctor. Leave me alone. But a lot of times the response is, oh, what is it? You know, and then they ask permission. Can we talk to your doctor about whether or not that could work for you? Oh, great. Yes, I'll talk to my doctor. I'll go to him and say, could I do this? What is it? You know, and then they'll kind of outline what that, and usually they're jobs that are a little bit not too hard, and they don't have a lot of physical requirements to them. they're almost seen as a little bit fun. So they're kind of like those kind of jobs. And so a lot of times they bring people back to work that were on a TD note, because any TD note, they look at it and say, well, maybe they could do this other thing. Could we do it if you did this? So they're quite creative. They don't even wait till they get a note with restrictions. They take an off work note or an illness slip and say, hey, we have these jobs, you know, that we'd love for you to do. And we could keep you working, you know. Yeah. I know your foot is broken. Could you do this if we set the foot up on a chair all day? Well, yeah, instead of being off for 6 weeks. Right. Why not?
A lot of people don't like being home. I know I would go crazy if I was off work for 6 weeks. But I did have that happen once about 25 years ago. I was like, oh my gosh, you know. So it really changed my notion and my own experience working with people with medical conditions. And so, I mean, what I would love to see happen here in San Diego County would be, like with my public agency, they actually, as soon as somebody was off of work for a medical condition, work-related, that they would send in a letter explaining their temporary modified duty program and to let the doctors know right up front, you know, because they had designated doctors, much like you do with your providers. Mm-hmm. And so that way it became a well-known thing that, you know, this particular employer had a regular, you know, temporary modified duty program and to support their employees in remaining employed with gainful income, et cetera, et cetera. And so it really changed your public reputation too.
And this large school district meets with the occupational doctors where they send their injured workers every month. Just to talk about how things are going, and they tell them exactly what they have available and really lean in with them, and they know them personally and they pick up the phone and call them. I always encourage all of our member school districts to go visit and see the waiting room and see where it is, see where you're sending your injured workers, not for urgent care or emergency room, but for care, for follow-up care, whether it's Concentra or Sharpie Steely or Work Partners. We partner in contract with everyone in San Diego, but whoever you choose to use, you should have a relationship where you pick up the phone, you actually know that doctor, you've actually met him in face to face, you know.
Yeah, I mean, much like you have a relationship with your own medical mm-hmm. provider, you know, in this case, you're simply establishing relationships with providers for your employees who are your work family. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, that's part of a manager's responsibility too. And so it's really a different mindset for different times. And, you know, particularly with things like COVID and the variants and just life in general, health conditions, you know, are on the rise and will continue to be. And particularly as, you know, we have an older workforce as well as a younger workforce, all kinds of things can happen.
Yes, we did a file review yesterday and I thought it was a typo. We had a 69-year-old bus driver and we had a 78-year-old custodian. It wasn't a typo. They were, you know, retirees that had come back to work in these positions, right? So we do have a lot of, and they both had been injured, right? Accidentally by students. One got pulled, their arm got pulled, and another one got knocked over, the little 78-year-old. So you're right. We do have quite a diverse workforce, I would say.
Yep. Well, very good. We covered quite a few things, the trends, you know, making accommodations around some of the exemptions. We didn't get into the religious thing because that's sort of out of the scope, so to speak, but to let everybody know that if they want more information, I've got information.
I wanted to add to that. There are some districts that have contacted me because they are thinking about putting in a mandatory vaccine policy more like LA Unified, where they don't offer the weekly testing. You must be vaccinated or, you know, that will affect your employment. Steps will be taken. With that, if you're crafting that kind of policy, then the sincerely held religious beliefs and the accommodation meetings for those and for medical conditions where you might not be able to get the vaccine become very important. Because when LA Unified did theirs, they had well over 1,000 requests for accommodations. I think they had over 1,500, if I remember the number. And so that becomes, it's not an issue if you're following the way our current protocol, but if you do go to that, then that topic is going to become very important for you.
Whole new ballgame, whole new set of rules. Yes. Mm-hmm. And then we also talked about some best practices. And I hope that between what you and I had to say, Felicia, that we've hopefully opened up some minds about, how could I do this differently? And then particularly, how our population of employees with medical conditions could potentially help out with this heavy workload that's being experienced on many different kinds of fronts. And so I'm excited about what the year can bring. And enjoy working with you and the JPA and all of your member districts. And always a learning process, isn't it?
Yes, I'm just so excited about my work. It's my passion.
Yeah. I can see that's very evident because you're always available whenever anybody has a question. And I know we chat regularly about issues as well. So, well, that's going to wrap up our December Q&A. And again, thank you for everyone who came back today, and I think I've got my problems worked out here. And wishing everyone a very Merry Christmas and Happy New Year, and wishing for a great 2022 coming forward, and look forward to seeing you all in the new year.
Happy holidays.
Thank you so much. Send us your questions if you have any.